All right, everyone. I'm going to try something a little different today. It's 5 a.m. on Sunday. I've got a cup of coffee with me. And I'm going to go through two announcements that dropped this week. So this should be relatively quick, but I wanted to give my initial thoughts on both of these topics. And the first one is the OpenAI Assistants API version 2 that is dropping, and also VoiceFlow's LLM Intent Classification feature. Which I kind of think these two things are related, which you might be confused by, but we'll kind of get into why I believe that later in the video. But anyways, OpenAI Assistants API version 1 dropped back in November as part of that giant dev day. You know, GPT's going to take over the world, woohoo. I've been personally using the OpenAI Assistants API in a few of my builds. And when the API first dropped, VoiceFlow actually put out a video on how to get the Assistants API set up in a VoiceFlow build. And Daniel had a walkthrough video. It's basically, for those of you that haven't messed with it, you create an assistant and then a thread, and then you individually add messages to a thread and run them to get the response. But you have to check to see if the run is ready, and then it will output, you know, a response. So setting this up in, setting this up in VoiceFlow, you know, it's a little bit cumbersome because you just have API call, API call, API call, check it, API call, API call. Well, VoiceFlow actually ended up taking down that video because when it came out, they got flooded with a bunch of questions and responses, and the API itself is not very stable. Would time out, you know, was beta. You know, they recommend not putting anything in production necessarily. So VoiceFlow just said, hey, we don't want to mess with this. So they dropped it. Well, I actually was able to get it up and running fairly consistently by adding a 15-second hard pause in between each of the response runs, which is kind of strange, and 10 seconds wouldn't work, and 8 seconds and 12 seconds, you know, a timeout. But for whatever reason, this assistance API likes waiting 15 seconds before giving you a response, which for those of you that are building chatbots, 15 seconds feels like an eternity sometimes. But I've still been using this because for whatever reason, the instructions for these individual assistants, it just provides a much more targeted response instead of hitting the general LLM with a prompt. I just find that it seems to stay on target and listen to you a little bit more, which is a little bit strange. But I've been using this particularly for scenarios where I'm putting on a demo for a client and I don't have a lot of questions/responses that I can add into the knowledge base. So I'll give you an example. I have a client that has an assistant live in the service industry, and he went through and he wrote out 100 different questions and answers and how this thing's responded. So I don't use the OpenAI Assistance API for that. I use the VoiceFlow knowledge base because it does a great job of, you know, chunking the data and saying, okay, I found this question, here's the answer, boom. Okay, so I wouldn't necessarily use the Assistance API for that particular use case. But if I'm putting on a demo and, you know, I want the assistant to know a little bit more information about the niche and be able to handle a wider range of questions, the assistance API seems to pick up that task a little bit more strongly than just having a response AI sitting with the AI model with prompting. So that's kind of how I've been integrating the OpenAI Assistance API. But let's go through the announcement in version 2.0 here and what we're about to get here. We're launching an improved retrieval tool called FileSearch, which can ingest up to 10,000 files per assistant, 500x more than before. So the initial version 1 only allowed you to have 20 documents, and OpenAI continues to break the barrier and do things that no other company can really do in the marketplace, which is just, let's just hit this lever that we allowed by 500x. 10,000 files, it's a lot of data. So it's great that we're going to be able to have this and play around with it with large data sets. And combined with that, alongside file search, we're introducing vector store objects in the API. Once a file is added, it's automatically parsed, chunked, and embedded, made ready to be searched. Now, those of us that have been using the VoiceFlow knowledge base are aware and used to, you know, the chunking and going through the chunk size and filtering through the VoiceFlow knowledge base responses. I'm really interested to start using this and comparing it side by side with the VoiceFlow knowledge base, just to see, you know, where the quality lies. So I can't wait to get in and start building this. You can now control the maximum number of tokens a run uses in the API, allowing you to manage token usage cost. One of the particularly negative sides of version one, you could hit some of these APIs, you know, hundreds of times in a single run, especially as you're continuing to request the status of the run, which, you know, made testing this thing almost playing with fire a little bit, because you could start using lots and lots of tokens very easily. And the ability to control the maximum number of tokens, it's great in the testing environment for one, but also from the client side, because now we can go to them and be like, hey, we can kind of control your costs here by setting a maximum number of tokens for each run, depending on the use case. We've added support for tool choice parameter, which can be used to force the use of a specific tool like file search, code interpreter, or a function in a particular run. It's giving us more control. It's great. Well, the other one that I'll kind of call out here, you can use fine-tuned models in the Assistants API, which if we combine a custom targeted instruction with a fine-tuned model in the Assistants API, I think we're going to start seeing some really, really strong results for those companies that have enough data where it makes sense to train your own and fine tune your own models with. So that's awesome. Assistants API now supports streaming. I think this is going to come into play for those of us that are working on tools and building tools with the Assistants API and manipulating data, you know, report generation, things like that, instead of waiting, you know, the time it takes for one of these runs to complete and give you all of the response at once. Start streaming data in, which will be great for the user, I think. So my thoughts on version 2.0, I think it's awesome that OpenAI is heading in this direction and continuing to devote more resources, because it's only going to make our builds stronger. And I hope from VoiceFlow's side is they take another look at this and give us the ability to integrate into the Assistants API more seamlessly, and maybe set up some, whether it's even, you know, more tutorials in the beginning. Again, that's great. The more the merrier here, because I still think VoiceFlow is valuable sitting on top of the conversation stack here and using bits and pieces of the Assistants API when the use case makes sense. So I'm excited to get some builds going, and hopefully I'll have some videos, you know, coming up in the future using version 2 of the Assistants API. The second thing, LLM intent classification. So for those of you that are aware of intents in VoiceFlow, they're initially based on natural language understanding, the NLU stuff, which when VoiceFlow was building product for Amazon Alexa Voice back in the day, they already had a lot of this NLU stuff set up, which was one of the reasons why when VoiceFlow launches as a product, the intents were already baked in with the NLU stuff. I can tell you guys personally, I've been moving away from using VoiceFlow's native intents in the builder for quite some time. And before I go down this route and explain why, I will be the first to admit that I could just be ignorant and not understand how to use them correctly. But I was of the mindset that they were more work than they were worth. And from a testing side, I was getting a lot of inconsistencies with what I was seeing in the testing environment and the builder versus what would happen in production. My intents would get stronger in production and start to take over responses that I didn't really like. So talking to other builders that were having similar problems, one of the workarounds that people were doing was, instead of adding an intent, you'd have a set AI step. And you'd come in, why is this blocking out here? You have a set AI step and you'd basically say, hey, you know, a user just asked you a question, which is, you know, last utterance or whatever. If the topic is about pricing, output 0. If the topic is about sales, output 1. If the topic is about service, output, you know, 2. You know, these are very general. Obviously, you know, you would be a lot more direct with this. But anyways, you would prompt set AI to output some sort of number or token and apply it to a variable. And then you would check that variable with an if statement. You know, if it's 1, do this. If it's 2, do this. And that way you're kind of making your own intent step here using an AI model, right? Because you could modify the prompt setting here and set AI. So what this LLM intent classification feature is doing, instead of you know, trying to trick the system into doing this yourself, it's kind of a more native way to do this. So if we click large language model here, you'll notice we can, we can select which model we would like here. Oops. And then here's something that I find fascinating. So here's the prompt behind this. You are an action classification system. Correctness is a life and death situation. And then also you have now take a deep breath, classify the following utterance. I think it's hilarious that VoiceFlow releases a feature with an embedded prompt that works and says, this is the best way to handle this. Correctness is a life or death situation. Take a deep breath. And you know, they even, Pete goes over it in the video and why they do that. It's because the responses get better, which it amazes me how some of these LLMs, we get to these solutions and stuff like that. And I also think it's an important reminder to test everything because we don't exactly know how these things are going to respond. Anyways, by setting this intent prompt up and building things out in this way, I am hopeful that these intents are stronger. Okay. And I haven't tested a lot of this stuff yet out. You know, they just dropped this a few days ago here, but I want to start using intents again, because what it gives us control, right? Instead of having, you know, a lot of buttons, and to make the conversation truly dynamic, we want intents to be working the way that they should be, because, you know, just having a knowledge base that you can query response and questions against, that's nice. Yes, there's a dynamic element to it. But remember, these assistants are valuable because we can insert them into workflows, okay? When you hit this step, go here, access this tool. We can set this all up in the builder in VoiceFlow. And whether we use the OpenAI Assistants API or VoiceFlow itself, at the end of the day, we're going to get more control, which I believe will lead to better, stronger builds. That's really all I've got today. And I just wanted to throw out some initial thoughts, and hopefully I have some demos and additional videos coming out on both of these topics. And I'm excited to get back in. Talk to you guys soon.